guest is an amazingly talented actor who also happens to be a wonderful singer. He's currently on Broadway playing an accountant dreaming of more, of a more exciting life. Here to perform I Want to Be a Producer, please welcome two-time Tony Award winner, Matthew Broderick, and the cast of The Producers.
I spend my life accounting with figures and such. To what is my life amounting? It figures not much. I have a secret desire hiding deep in my soul. It sets my heart afire to see me in this role. A producer with a hit show on Broadway. I want to be a producer, lunch at Sardi's every day. I want to be a producer, sport a top hat and a cane. I want to be a producer and drive those chorus girls insane. Sleep until half past two. I want to be a producer and say you, not you. I want to be a producer, wear a tux on opening night. I want to be a producer and see my name Leo bloom in lights.
Performance, sir.
Thank you.
Can I say, I can't believe, and I don't know if everyone knows, that before you did How to Succeed, you never really were a singer.
That's right.
It's shocking to hear how great your voice is.
Oh, thank you very much. Thank you.
Did you
and it's 7 a.m. or whatever it was.
Yeah.
Oh, I mean now.
Yeah, now, when you did that just a few minutes ago. And I was here, not on Good Morning
Never
America.
Been good at that.
Anyway, the thing is, you really studied after How to Succeed, someone told me? You took lessons and everything?
Yeah, I did, you know. I studied before How to Succeed, too, you know, and then I just kept at it. And, you know, I don't know if I'm any better, but I keep at it. You know, I work hard at it.
I mean, you're a song and dance man, mister. I got news for you. You're really amazing.
Yeah. Well, you know, the jazz classes and all the classes I take.
It's so tough with the leg warmers and the unitard.
I have a dance belt on right now.
You do, actually. It's always nice to wear one. Now, is it true that you heard you were doing this part from reading it in the paper? That can't be true.
That's how I found out, sort of, yeah. I ran into to Tom Meehan, who co-wrote the book with Mel Brooks, and he said, you know, Mel Brooks wants to speak to you about the producers. He's really interested in you. And I was, oh, good. And nobody ever called my agent or called me. And then I read in the paper, you know, that I was being pursued to do the producers, and people would say, they really mean it, you know, they're not kidding. And I'd call my agent and say, is anybody, no, nobody's calling from the producers.
Right.
And that went on for quite a while. Yeah. And then,
did anyone ever think of possibly calling them and saying, everyone keeps saying you want him, and maybe you do?
I don't know. I don't think, I guess you know how agents are. They're like, let them come to us.
Exactly.
Let's be smart for once.
Exactly, Milk more money out of them. You know how Broadway is such a lucrative money-making business for the actor.
Yeah.
Yes, indeed. Yeah. Are you having fun with Nathan?
Yeah, Nathan is
Nathan
great.
Nathan Lane is also starring
in
this.
He's the funniest person in the world, and he's great in the show. And,
he really is hysterical.
Yeah. And it's like a role made for him. As much as Zero Mostel it was when he did the movie, it's just as much for Nathan now, you know, I think. It's like watching Ethel Merman, you know. Yeah. In her heyday.
Have you had any mishaps yet on stage? Any?
Well, you know, we have the odd thing where a mic goes out or... Right. And the funny thing about Nathan is anything that happens, if somebody drops something, he can't not comment on it.
Right.
A door gets stuck, he says, must be the weather or something. You know, he loves to say something. And then I hear him say something and I... Well, it is spring, or you know, I want to get in there too.
Yeah,
and
sure.
And then he always, bam, then he'll top me.
Yeah, yeah.
I never
he's
get the
good at that.
He's very good at
Mr.
it.
Mr. Improv.
He sure is.
Yeah.
And he just pounds me under the table whenever we try that stuff.
Were you intimidated working with Mel Brooks? Because come on, Mel Brooks.
Yes, I'm a lifelong fan of his. The 2000-year-old man, those records I wore out listening to, Young Frankenstein, the producers, and so to even meet him. Which is finally how I found out that they did want me. I had a meeting with Mel Brooks, and he said, we want you.
So right.
I said, oh, okay. And so I was very intimidated, but I'm very happy to have the chance to work with him now.
But, You know, I sat next to him on a plane once.
You did?
Yeah, I had never met him, and he happened to be sitting next to me. And he said, you in that baseball movie, kid? I said, yeah. He said, Mel, you got to hold my hand for takeoff and landing. I'm a bad flyer. And he held my hand the whole flight.
He's so sweet.
And he told me the most amazing stories about when he fell in love with Anne Bancroft and he used to follow her around.
Yes, I know that one. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's very touching.
It is.
Yeah, he would show up at restaurants. He knew where she was going to be. And he'd stage it so that he'd be sitting there and then she'd come and he'd say, again?
Yeah.
And bankrupt again in the same restaurant? This is incredible.
Right. Cause
and it went on for about a week.
Because her assistant, he kept giving
he kept
the assistant
calling,
money. Where's she going to be?
Okay, and he'd get a reservation.
But obviously it worked because,
it did
you
work.
Know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's nuts about her. She's around all the time, too. Yeah. They both come to the show, you know, most of the time.
Right. I was very nervous when we had her on the show. She did an interview once, and I was very nervous. You know, it's Anne Bancroft.
I mean, I know, legend.
And Mel Brooks.
I know.
It's hard.
It's
you're working.
Big time. I know. You get used to it, though.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, when you work with, because he's so concentrating on the thing that you forget. You know.
What'd you do for your big birthday, sir? 39. One more year till we're the big 40.
I know. Do you find people think you're lying?
Yes,
like,
all the time.
How old are you? 39. Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, 39.
Yeah, you'll be 39 forever, I guess.
Yeah, yeah.
No, and I always find 1962, graduated in 1980. That's what I say is proof.
See?
Like, how else would I know that?
Right.
You know?
I know, no way I would be that good
no
a liar.
No way I could do math like that in my head. But, 30, did you do a big party? Are you a big birthday boy or no?
Well, I was, for one thing, sad not to be here.
Yeah, because usually...
Often.
We have the big birthday.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I get some kind of nice present or something. I don't know, but I get it.
Yeah.
But It was our first preview,
yes.
So we.
You were busy.
We had a preview, and then they had a party, like a first preview and Matthew's birthday party.
Yeah.
Which isn't great because it's really it's two parties, so they're not focusing enough on that
on
it's
you
your birthday
at all. You know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
What is it? Is it an opening or me?
Yeah. Yeah. Right.
Presents? Nah, it's kind of an opening. Let's not get any
yeah,
presents.
Yeah. That doesn't seem fair at all.
It isn't fair. It's not right.
I was thinking maybe you know since I really didn't get a big birthday this year either.
Yeah.
I was doing some charity event I had committed to not realizing it was on my birthday.
That was a mistake.
That was an error in judgment.
Yeah.
You know, that was three therapy sessions about, you know, you think other people's needs are more than your own celebration of your existence. I'm like, shut up, here's your $400.
Why don't you ever reward yourself?
Exactly.
What's you're wrong with taking care
it
of Rosie?
Rosie needs to come
yeah
first. Do you understand? How do you feel about Rosie? You know how I feel? I feel like leaving therapy.
Yeah.
That's how I feel.
Here.
But so maybe we should do ours like 6 months later.
Sure.
You know, maybe we can have a little half year celebration, you and I together.
39 and a half.
39
it
and a half.
It might be good because the next one is going to be so incredibly depressing that
yeah,
maybe we should have it.
Or let's have a joint big 4-0 party.
That might be a good idea.
Yeah.
Gotta do something.
Maybe we'll rent out Chelsea Piers, you and me. We'll invite all our friends.
I'll do it.
All right, then. I don't know if we have enough friends to fill Chelsea Piers.
How much will that cost?
Oh, don't worry. We'll get it for free. We just set it on TV.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll get it. It don't matter. All right, tell everybody you're opening when? On the 19th?
April 19th.
And it's in previews
at
now.
At the St. James.
Right.
And it's in previews now, and Mel Brooks and Susan Stroman directed it, and Nathan Lane and me, and it's really hilarious. And a lot of other great people, Gary Beach, you know, a lot of great
people. And although this is not out yet, it will be soon, and they gave me an advanced copy of the CD, so when will that be out, do you know?
Roger Bart, Kitty Huffman, I should mention more people. this will be out, I have no idea when this will be out.
In a month. In 1 month, this will be out.
Is that right?
Or the 17th of April, which is more appropriate than a month. On the 17th of April, you can buy this. Don't do it. Delightful to see you, young man.
Nice to see you, too.
I'll see you in a week or two.
Yeah.